So we now start a new topic, which is the kinematics of rigid bodies. So as usual, okay, that most of the material is covered from Beer and Johnston, 10th edition, okay, fabulous resources are available, you can have a look at them. So let us introduce now, what is kinematics of rigid bodies? Now previously, we were all discussing about, okay, points. Now what is the big deal about points? We had briefly discussed when we started our session on kinematics, that there is nothing in this world which is actually a point, okay, but then what is the point of taking something as a point, okay, the point being, okay, so too many points here, okay, but the idea behind this thing is that if a particular body completely translates without having any rotational component, then what we say is that all those rotational components we don't bother about, and essentially we can assume as if entire mass of that body is concentrated at the centroid, center of gravity, okay, or center of mass, there are various names that go with it. Most common name is the center of mass, and we say that we can directly apply Newton's law for that, that sum of all the forces, external forces acting on that rigid body is nothing but the mass times the acceleration of the center of mass, done. So this was Newton's laws of motion, okay, for translation, okay, in for rigid bodies without any mention to rotation, that we don't really need to have a point, okay. What we can do is that we can just say that all the that if there is no rotation, then the only thing we need to worry about are the two translations or three translations, depending we are in 2D or 3D for that part, for the center of mass of that body, and the overall external force acting on it is nothing but mass times the acceleration of the center of mass, and done, okay, we are done with this. And just to refresh ourselves, what did we do? We said that for a mass, sum of all the forces, vectorial forces, is equal to m times acceleration, okay, where m is the total mass, okay, it is a very important equation, we are going to use it again and again now, even while discussing kinetics of rigid bodies. And a bar is the total, is the acceleration of cm. Okay, and how do we define cm? For a collection of particles, cm ka x bar is defined as sum mi xi divided by, okay, so this is x bar divided by sigma mi, and as a result x bar dot is equal to mi vi bar dot v bar divided by mi, and the acceleration of the center of mass is nothing but mi vi bar dot, okay, divided by sum of the masses or all of these things, okay. So this is simply, okay, Newton's laws, okay, for a rigid body, we can also, which can also be thought of as a bunch of particles put together. Now let us go into actual details of what if we have a rigid body, what kind of motions are possible, okay, and how do we take those motions, understand the kinematics, okay, what is kinematics, is what possible translations, rotations, what are the accelerations present in that rigid body, and we use that information to figure out that if there are certain amount of forces and couples, torques, okay, whatever you want to use the word, okay, those are acting on the body and they result in linear acceleration as well as angular acceleration. Now for a rigid body, okay, what are the possible motions, okay? So simple rigid body motions can be classified as just simple translation, that a rigid body is present and the rigid body just move, okay, like this in a 3D environment or in a 2D plane, okay, there is no rotation whatsoever, and that was kind of the definition of particle we had used, that there is only translation and the rotation is not playing any role into the quantities of our interest, okay. So we can have a simple translation, just a rectilinear translation, or we can have a curvilinear translation. Now what is a curvilinear translation? The curvilinear translation is as follows. So let us take it like this, here, okay, no rotation, no rotation again, no rotation. Now what do I mean by no rotation? The definition of no rotation is that that let us take two points A and B, which are joined by a straight line on this rigid body. Now, no rotation means that this AB always remains vertical. This angle of AB, it never changes. Okay, it always remains like this. This is what we mean when we say that there is no rotation. But now note that in this problem, the trajectory which is traveled by the center of mass is no longer straight, it is curved. But still there is no rotation, that any line AB which I draw on a rectangular mass will always remain straight. Okay, that angle, whatever it is at t is equal to 0, at any other arbitrary time, that angle always remains the same, and that is why we say that there is no rotation, it is still a translation, but it is curvilinear translation. Why? Because the center of mass now is no longer moving in a straight line, it has a direction, okay, so it has a change of direction, and as a result, the center of mass, if you just track CM, you will see that the CM also has tangential acceleration and it can also have a normal acceleration like we did for a particle. That if you treat this center of mass as a particle, then whatever we discussed about the curvilinear motion previously, okay, they all apply here also. But the only difference here is that now there is an additional degree of freedom that we have to worry about, which is that this line need not always remain straight, okay, it can undergo rotation, and that additional component, okay, we had completely neglected when we had done kinetics and kinematics of particles. Now, what is the other type of motion that we can have rotation about a fixed axis? So, what is rotation about a fixed axis? Is for example, we take our rectangle, okay, our favorite rectangle which we had been discussing so far. Let us say that this rectangle is hinged about its center, okay, there is a pin here. Now, let us say we draw this line here AB. What can happen is that this rectangle can start having some rotation about this hinge O. So, this line AB is no longer straight now, it can have further rotation, this is B, this is A. So, this is one motion, okay, and this point O need not be just at the centroid, it can be at any other point, but just for argument's sake, we took it to be at the centroid. This is called as pure rotation, okay, about a point. Okay, this is pure rotation. Why? Because the center of mass or one point is completely fixed, and you can say that this is just a pure rotation about this point, that we don't have to worry about any translations for the time being. Okay, so this is pure rotation about point, and in this case that point is O. Then what we can have is we can have a general plane motion. Now, what is a general plane motion? We definitely know what that plane motion is. For example, if you recall what we had done when we had solved variety of problem using principle of virtual works, those ideas, okay, the kind of kinematic displacements we had given to various structures, okay, rotations, translation, combination of them, they are going to come really handy when we discuss kinematics, okay, up to velocity of these rigid bodies. So, take example of our favorite ladder leaning against a wall, okay, AB. Now, this ladder can undergo a motion like this. That A comes to A prime and B comes to B prime. But if you remember what we had done, we had said that this particular motion can be broken down into two parts. We can say that we can pin this ladder about point A and let the ladder undergo rotation. Okay, so, this is the initial configuration of the ladder. Let the ladder undergo a small rotation about point A. But what happens when this is done? When this is done, this point B double prime loses contact with the ground. And we do not want that to happen because that is inconsistent with the overall kinematics of the with the overall geometry of our problem. But then what we do is that further we apply a translation in the y direction, and then what happens is that overall translation when we apply in the y direction by how much amount? By this much amount, then we say that the final configuration of the ladder is like this. So, we can say now that this particular motion is a combination of translation and rotation. that in this case we can think of that to be a rotation about point O and a translation in the y direction. Equivalently, you can also think of this as rotation about point B and translation in the horizontal direction. Both are perfectly equivalent. So, a general planar motion can be broken into two parts, which is rotation about any point and a corresponding translation. Many a times it becomes very simple to take that point of rotation as a centroid, but in many other problems, as we will see, okay, you can choose a point appropriately to decide about which you want to rotate and then decide how do you want to translate. So, that is completely dependent on us. But the only thing is that any general planar motion can always be decomposed into rotation about a point for that body and followed by a corresponding translation. Okay? That is the most general motion in 2D. And in 3D, we can also have motion about a fixed point, like for example, a spinning of a top. Okay? So, these are the motion which are a little bit complicated, not really complicated, but it requires more visualization and it is kind of beyond the scope of what we are going to do now. So, I will not go into details of that. So, this is motion about a fixed point, like for example, spinning of a top, where it can spin, it can do this what is called as a nutation and it can go around, which is called as precession. So, it can do these three kinds of motion, which is motion about a fixed point. And a general motion is that there are 3 degrees of freedom for translation, 3 degrees of freedom for rotation, and that is the most general planar motion. So, what we are going to focus on, okay, we had already focused in our previous kinematics of particles on translation, both rectilinear and curvilinear. Okay. In this today's lecture, okay, we are going to focus on rotation about a fixed axis and general plane motion. Now, let us look at these motions in detail. Now, why I am going into all these things in detail? The same reason why we had gone into lot of details of kinematics of particles. Why? Because unless and until we understand what overall kinematics is, so what are the velocity components, what are the acceleration components, okay, what is angular acceleration, what is curvilinear acceleration and so on. Unless and until we have a decent handle over that, it will be impossible for us to do kinetics where we, for example, relate the applied forces and applied torque with mass times the acceleration and moment of inertia times alpha. Okay, what that quantity is, okay, we will come to that, okay, very soon. Now, what is translation? So, rigid body translation, okay, is that for any two particles, let us take I have particle A, I have particle B. Then we say, okay, we can easily say, okay, this is a cliche or a standard definition that the position vector of B with respect to a fixed origin is given by position vector of A plus position vector of B with respect to A. Now, for a pure translational motion, what we had seen is that this position vector, if there is no rotation, then this position vector just keep translating as a function of time. What does that mean is that this position vector, the relative position vector between any two points in translation does not change in time, or in other words, if I take derivative of this with respect to time, then what we will see is that this becomes 0. Why? Because relative position of B with respect to A, okay, for any arbitrary points A and B will always remain constant. That vector will just remain this, keep moving, okay, in 2D or 3D, whatever dimension we want to work in, planar motion, non-planar motion, does not matter. This remains constant. And as a result, velocity of B will always be equal to velocity of A for any point. And when that happens, okay, we say that the body is undergoing pure translation. And since the velocity is also constant for every point, we will see that acceleration of all the points, okay, is the same. And now it makes perfect sense that when a rigid body is undergoing pure translation, then we don't have to worry about anything about rotation and so on, because all particles have the same acceleration. Then I can as well think that this is one small particle with all the mass concentrated at the center of mass, okay, and my total force equal to F times ma. This is pure translation. Now, let us come to this concept. This is again very important concept, is rotation about a fixed axis. Because why? We had just seen a few moments ago that any general motion, okay, for everybody, for even for 3D, but definitely for planar problems which we are going to discuss, that can be thought of as a rotation about a fixed point or a fixed axis and followed by translation. So, in 3D we have to talk about axis, in 2D we can talk about a point. Why? Because the axis essentially is now the z axis, which is out of plane. So, essentially there is no rotation about a point per se, it is properly defined only in terms of rotation about an axis. But when we do 2D, we say rotation about a point. Why? Because essentially that point is nothing but z axis. Okay? But because we are doing in 2D, we say that it is rotation about a point. But a rotation about a fixed axis, okay, what happens about the kinematics of that? So you just go through this a small derivation here, okay, you have to do some visualization using calculus, okay, stare at this diagram for some time, but what you will realize is that for pure rotation about an axis, okay, that this is the axis over which the rigid body is rotating about, okay, we see so many times, for example, a spinning top, okay, if you think in 3D, what is the axis it is rotating about, for example, okay, we can always figure out if it is just vertically spinning, then the axis going through the midpoint of the top is the spinning axis. But then this axis becomes more complicated if the top is undergoing more complicated motions, okay. But still, we can always figure out, okay, that there will be certain motions, for example, in which the motion is happening about a fixed axis, and in that case, the velocity of any point, okay, now this is the origin that we are fixing. There is no translation. Why? Because we are saying that it is a pure rotation about a fixed axis. Now let us put some origin, okay, one point along this axis, and we say that we find out the position vectors with respect to that origin point. What do we have? V bar of any point, okay, can be written as dr by dt, and this can be shown to be equal to omega cross r, where omega is what? Omega is the angular velocity of that particle about the axis of rotation, okay. So this is omega equal omega cross r, and now when we are doing 2D planar objects, then the axis of rotation is nothing but a z axis. What is the direction? Okay, what is the direction of this omega vector? It is nothing, but if this is the direction of rotation, clockwise or anticlockwise, we just curl our right hand around it, okay, and the thumb, the direction it points out, okay, if this is x, this is y. If this is the anticlockwise is the direction of rotation, then the rotation is happening about the z axis, okay, and you can see that this will be nothing but equal to the theta dot quantity that we had seen earlier, that theta dot is nothing but the omega of rotation for that object. Now, what is the acceleration for rotation about a fixed axis? We just saw that acceleration is dv by dt, but what was v? V was nothing but omega cross r. We do the derivatives. When we do all the derivatives, what we will realize is that the total acceleration is given by d omega bar by dt cross r, okay, that is acceleration, plus omega bar cross v. This is the most general expression. Now, what we are interested for in the time being, okay, is let us think about what happens, okay, when we are, okay, in the plane. So what we can think about is that d omega by dt is this quantity which is called as the angular acceleration. So for example, in planar motion, okay, what we see is that the theta double dot quantity which we had seen earlier, okay, is essentially, or it is equivalent to what is this quantity called as alpha, that there is a pure rotation about a point, okay, and for any point on the rigid body, okay, if I draw a simple diagram here, this is a planar motion, this is the point about which the rotation is happening, then if you connect any point here, r bar, then for complete rigid rotation of this body, what do we know, okay, take this particle, what we will realize is that the acceleration of this point A will have two components, that A bar will be equal to alpha r. What is the direction of that? The direction is perpendicular to this, and another component will be, which will be along the direction E theta, okay, and the second one will be A r, okay, what will that be equal to? That will be equal to omega square r into minus E r. Now, this can also be expressed in terms of tangential and normal components, and how we do that, okay, we will come to that in a few moments. Tangential and normal directions. So, this A bar now has two components, one is alpha cross r and other is omega cross r. And what we realize is that for a planar motion, that rotation about a fixed slab, okay, about point O, so about O means essentially is happening about the z axis, what is that? That this v velocity, if you take this point O about which the pure rotation is happening, we want to find out that instantaneously, okay, what is the velocity at this point P? What is the velocity of this point P? What do we do? It is nothing but omega cross r. What is omega? Omega is in this direction, which is omega k. K is what? The unit vector along the z direction. So, it is omega k cross r, and you will see that this direction will only be perpendicular to this line, and the magnitude will be given by r times omega, and the direction will be this. Similarly, to talk about acceleration of any point, what do? It is alpha cross r, okay, plus omega cross r. Now, what is this alpha vector? This alpha vector is again, okay, its direction is out of plane, okay. So, it is alpha, the magnitude, times k hat, which is the unit vector in the z direction. So, we can rewrite this as alpha k cross r minus omega square r bar. What is r bar? R bar is essentially this, okay. So, when we just resolve this, okay, we can say that this, because this entire object is rotating purely about point O, the trajectory that this point P will follow will be along the arc of a circle. Why? Because this distance is now remaining constant. So, the trajectory that is followed by P will be along the arc of a circle. And then what we can say is that now the acceleration is coming because of two parts. Why? Because the velocity magnitude or the speed can change while this particle moves along the arc of a circle because of this rotation, okay, because of change in the magnitude of the speed, and that particular component is this component r times alpha, where alpha is the angular acceleration, which is nothing but omega dot, okay, that is the angular acceleration. And the second component of acceleration comes, why? Because the velocity is always perpendicular to this position vector, because of it is moving in a circle, and as a result, okay, the direction of this velocity keeps on changing, and that will lead to the acceleration in the normal direction a n. And what is the magnitude? Okay, it will be equal to minus omega square r bar, okay, or in other words, its magnitude, okay, is r omega square in the normal direction. So, if I go back to this slide, okay, we can say that this point P, okay, this is point P, because of this rotation, this point P is now going to follow the arc of a circle, and at any point P, at any point along the trajectory, this is a position vector, its velocity is directed like this. This is also the tangent direction, this is the normal direction, and what we are saying is that the acceleration in this tangent direction, the magnitude of that is nothing but alpha times r, where r is this distance, and the acceleration in the normal direction is nothing but minus omega square r, okay, where omega is also rate at which the angle changes, and alpha is theta double dot or equal to omega dot. So, this is as simple as that. So, this is the simple kinematics of rotation about a fixed axis. Now, think about this, okay, let us look at it. Let us look at various cases. If this uniform rotation alpha, okay, if the rotation of this rigid body, it is constantly moving at the same angular speed, then omega dot in that case is 0. You have a planar body, okay, which is rotating at a constant angular speed, then this quantity alpha is 0. So, what we can say? Alpha is nothing but theta dot, the rate at which this angle theta changes, okay. And so, like we did for the rectilinear motion, we can say that alpha is equal to d omega by dt, okay, which can also be written as omega into d omega by d theta. Recall, we had said that rectilinear acceleration will be written as d v by dt, which can also be written as v dv by dx. So, exact same analogy. Now, for this rotation about a fixed point, we just know that this is alpha, and now we want to find out that if we know that the angular acceleration, which is theta double dot, is this alpha, how can we find out that what is the angular velocity as a function of time, what is the angular velocity as a function of rotation, and what is the rotation as a function of time. So, these are all possible questions that we can ask, and we can use this, we can integrate these equations using the same ideas that we had discussed for rectilinear motion. And for uniform rotation, when there is no angular acceleration, it is uniform circular motion, okay, then theta will be equal to theta naught plus omega t straight away. For uniformly accelerated rotation of a rigid body, that this theta dot is now constant, okay, alpha. So, we can do the integration again, and we will see that omega is equal to initial omega naught plus alpha t, theta is equal to theta naught plus omega t plus alpha t square, and same formula like in rectilinear motion for this omega. So, we can do all these quantities, okay, all the games we had played for rectilinear motion, now we can also play for planar rotation, okay, of a rigid body about a fixed point. Now, let us do this very simple problem, okay, with this much discussion. What we have is that this is one mechanism, this is a drive belt, what is this drive belt used to do? This drive belt is used to drive a pulley. So Professor Shobhik Banerjee had discussed various ideas about belt friction and so on. We are not going to go into intricate details of that, but simple kinematics of a mechanism where a driving belt is driving this pulley. Now what we are told is that this driving belt or this driving cable has a constant acceleration of 225 meters per second in this direction and an initial velocity of 300 millimeters per second both in this direction. And with this information, and also we are given that this rope maintains a constant contact with this pulley, okay, then determine the number of revolutions of the pulley, that how many times this pulley revolve in 2 seconds about this point A, and the pulley can undergo pure rotation about point O. Second thing is the velocity and in change in position of this load B after 2 seconds. Then what happens is that when this you are keeping pulling, if this pulley keeps on rotating in the clockwise direction, why? Because this point C moves sideways. As a result, this pulley will be forced to rotate in this direction, okay, in the clockwise direction, and this point B will start moving up. How? Because this pulley rotate, the external one is connected to the pulley, that also rotates and this goes up. So that is the work done by this driving cable. And what we are asked to find out is the number of revolution that this pulley undergoes in 2 seconds, the velocity and the change in position of B after 2 seconds, that what is the velocity and how much it moves up by, and the acceleration of the point D on the rim of the inner pulley, that what is the acceleration for this point at time t is equal to 0. Now note one thing, that point D, okay, will have two components of acceleration. Why? Because this inner pulley is rotating with an angular speed of omega and also with an angular acceleration alpha. What that angular acceleration is, we will figure that out, okay. So point D, okay, will have the same speed in the tangential direction as this cable C. So velocity of this cable is Vc in this direction is the same as velocity of point D. Why? Because these two are linked with each other. Okay, point D is common both to the cable and to the pulley, and if there is no slip between this pulley and the cable, then both of them should have the same speed. The point D on the pulley and point D on the cable are connected to each other, okay, they are common to both of them, and in the absence of any slippage, they will have the same velocity. What is that? 300 meters per second. Now what is the acceleration of D in the tangential direction? It has to be again the same as the acceleration of this point C, because that is a tangential component, okay. So both of them will have the same acceleration. Now what do we know from our previous discussion? Because it is a pure rotation about point D, this tangential velocity should be equal to R times omega 0, where what is that omega 0 is the initial angular speed of this pulley. Now what do we want to do? Acceleration of point D in the tangential direction, what will that be equal to again? Okay, because they are all connected with each other, this has an angular acceleration of alpha, okay, with respect to rotation about point A, so the tangential angular acceleration will be nothing but R times alpha. So what we do, we just put these equations together, we realize that omega 0 is equal to initial velocity, which is 300 divided by R, and from that we can find out that omega 0 is 4 radians per second in the horizontal, 4 radians per second, what direction it is? It is going in the plane, okay, use the right hand thumb rule, okay. What is the direction of the velocity? Is this, so in the plane of the paper will be the corresponding vector. Now always note one thing, that omega has to be represented in terms of radians per second, okay. If you have a question about that, you ask me, but omega should always be represented in terms of radians per second for safety purposes. There are some applications in which you can immediately use that omega can be in degrees per second or number of revolutions, but if you want to find out what is the distance that is travelled, okay, by the pulley, okay, or then in that case that omega should be in radians per second. Now what is alpha? Again just use this thing, use these two equations, we will find out that alpha will be this tangential acceleration divided by R, which will again come out to be 3 radians per second square. Now we want to find out that after 2 seconds what happens? What we do? We use the simple equations for constant acceleration. We are given that the acceleration is constant, and what are the equations? Okay, these are the equations for omega, theta and omega square as a function of time and as a function of theta or the rotation. So just substitute in all these values here, we can find out what is omega as a function of time. At t is equal to 2 seconds substitute, you will see that omega for this pulley will be equal to 10 radians per second. Again substitute, okay, this is theta, what will theta be equal to? Omega t plus half a t square, substitute everything, you will realize that the total rotation that this internal pulley has undergone is 14 radians. And then what is the number of revolutions? Number of revolutions is just simply this. So 2 pi times the number of revolutions will be equal to the number of radians, okay? And then just put them all together, we will see that the number of revolutions after 2 seconds is 2.23. What is the velocity of point B after 2 seconds? Now note that as far as this point is concerned, okay, where this B is connected by a string to the outer pulley. Now the this point, okay, where the this mass B is connected to the pulley is common both to the string and both to this outer pulley. And if there is no slippage between these two, okay, what we realize is that, okay, since they are in the form of this spool, okay, this velocity, the velocity of the point which is to the pulley, which is a part of the pulley, and the velocity of the point which is a part of this string should be equal. And as a result, the velocity of this point is nothing but r times the omega of this entire assembly. That omega we already found out, and then we can find out what is the velocity of this in the upward direction, and subsequently what is the overall displacement in the y direction, that how much theta it has undergone into r will be the total displacement of this thing in the y direction. That is nothing but r times this q is essentially theta, okay, this is just a typo. R times theta will be the distance that this point B move in the vertical direction, okay. So all these quantities, okay, by connecting what is alpha, what is theta dot, all with the r, with the corresponding dimensions of the pulley, okay, we can find out what are the corresponding accelerations, motion, displacements, and velocities of various points in this structure. If there are any questions, okay, please let me know. So give two examples of general plane motion. Okay, one simplest example of a general plane motion is, for example, if you have a cylinder rolling on a slope, if you take a coin, okay, and make it roll, okay, exactly in one plane, okay, along a straight line. Or for example, when a car moves or when a bike moves in a straight line, okay, then that particular motion, okay, of the wheel is a simple example of a general plane motion, okay. Or for example, if I take a pen like this and exactly throw it like this, okay, with some acceleration, without, by taking care that there is no rotational component in the out of plane direction, that I don't do this, but just throw it in one direction, then that is one simple example of a general plane motion. What does general plane motion means? General plane motion means that the center of mass of the particle, okay, it stays in that plane, and not only the center of mass, the entire object, okay, okay, or there is one plane of the object which entirely, or the plane of symmetry of the objects completely stays in that plane. So either you have a very flat object like a paper, and if this paper keeps on moving like this in one plane, you can call that as a planar motion. Or if, for example, I have a ball, but that ball also, I take the central axis of the ball, okay, just cut it through the center and keep track of that central plane. And if that central plane, okay, keeps moving exactly in one xy plane rather than having these kind of components, then that is example of general plane motion. That it does this rotation and it also does this translation. But why is it planar? Because there is no component, okay, that no part of this object has any velocity, okay, or any displacement or any acceleration in the out of plane direction, okay. That is a simple, those are the simple examples of general plane motion, okay. This is the question asked by center 1177. Center 1224 have asked that why do we study LIDAR as a 2D problem and not a 3D problem, okay, pure idealization, okay. Clearly, if you have a rod leaning against a wall, in principle, okay, if I give it a motion like this, then the rod can also undergo a motion in 3 dimension, and this need not be a planar motion. But if you take a ladder like this and give it a perturbation only in this direction, so that the ladder keeps on moving like this, then the overall motion is happening in only one plane, and we say that it's a planar motion. So planar motion is one possible motion for the ladder which is leaning against two walls, okay. But that doesn't mean that that's the only motion it can have. It can also undergo motion like this, okay. And for the purposes of this course, okay, where we are not going to go into details of 3D or general translation and rotation, we are solving simple problems in planar motion. We are taking this specific case where the ladder is perturbed in such a way that it has all the motions in one plane, okay. There is no component of motion which goes out of plane. That is the only reason. But definitely a ladder can have a motion which is a general 3D motion. No question about that, okay. So center number 1059, the question asked is, please explain the concept of degree of freedom for a rigid body by considering n number of particles. Okay. See, this n number of particle is a simple idealization. Okay. So, let me discuss that. Okay. For simplicity, for the time being, let us take the case of a planar motion. Okay. We have a notebook like this. Okay. And suppose this book falls from our hand by mistake. Now, what can happen is that, this can undergo a motion like this, where if you track this point O, this point A, O has moved. So, there is clearly a translation. Also, if you take A and B as another two points, then we will see that this A and B, the distance does not change for a rigid body, but they can undergo a rotation like this. Now, what we can think of is that, this entire rigid body, we can think of as a bunch of points, an infinite number of points. And the same rule that we have applied for this centroid O and for these two points A and B, we can play the same game with these two other points, let me call them P and Q. And then what will happen is that after the rotation, you will see that P and Q will look like this. After more time, this P and Q, okay, may also look like this. But for a rigid body, what is true is that, the actual distance, okay, this length PQ does not change, but the orientation of the PQ and the overall translation of the PQ can change. So, any rigid body can be thought of as an infinite number of points, and what is the concept is that, you choose any two points, a general planar motion of those two points, okay, because when you join two lines, that line can undergo a general motion, and the general motion can be a translation. What is the translation in any 3D? If I take a bottle like this, what are the motions that I can give it to it? What are the degrees of freedom? One is translation in the x direction, other is translation in the y direction, translation in the z direction. Now, x, y, z are purely chosen as some nomenclature. Okay? You can have this a, b, c, p, q, r, x prime, y prime, z prime, whatever. But it can have these three independent degrees of freedom. Okay? But not only that, there can be a rotation about z axis, there can be rotation about y axis, x axis, and there can be rotation about the y axis. So, these are the 6 degrees of freedom that are possible for any general 3D motion. But when we take the case of a 2D planar motion, what do we say? That a 2D plane, okay, that the motions that are possible are like we did in 2D equilibrium, that one translation is possible, vertical translation is possible, and this third rotation, which is rotation about axis z, is also possible. So, for planar motion, okay, what is a planar motion? Either the object is very thin like a plain paper and there is no motion that is happening out of plane, the only motions happening are is 1, 2 and 3, we say that this is a planar motion. Or the object may be, okay, something like, for example, a sphere, but the sphere, okay, if you cut the sphere through the center of symmetry of the sphere, if the sphere is moving in such a way that it has only motions are the rotation about the z axis, translation in the x and translation in the y axis, even though the sphere is not strictly a 2D object, okay, or not a thin object, what we can say is that there is one plane that I can find on the sphere where all the particles on that plane undergo only a planar motion, okay, that they don't undergo this kind of motion, like for example, swing of a ball. Those motions are non-planar motions. They only undergo three motions in plane, and that is another example, or a cylinder rolling along an incline. The cylinder has an object, okay, it has a thickness in the third direction. But if we cut the cylinder through the center, what we see is that particular plane, the projection is like a circle, and we can as well say that it's like a disc which is rolling down the ground or which is rolling on a flat surface. So, that is a concept of degrees of freedom, and what do we mean by saying that a motion is a planar motion or a 2D motion. Okay? I hope that this explanation is clear. So, now let us move on. Now, this is one example of a general plane motion, okay, as we had just discussed, okay, that what is a planar motion? That this object is very thin, okay, and so we say that the motion is essentially planar and that it doesn't have any translation or rotation out of plane. So, we say that this is a planar motion, but we can also have that this need not be a disc. This can as well be a sphere, and sphere is a three-dimensional object, but what we are doing essentially is that we are cutting through the center of the sphere and that projection is essentially a circle, and if the sphere doesn't undergo lateral motion, only undergo motion in this plane, okay, that the center plane, it doesn't undergo some motion like this, just undergo motion in one plane, then we say that this is a plane motion. So, one of the most general plane motion is rolling of a disc or rolling of a sphere on the plane ground. A general motion, as we had seen, is neither a pure translation nor a pure rotation. And even from the example that we had discussed about the ladder, okay, slipping in one plane, it can also slip outside the plane, but one simple example is when the ladder keeps slipping in one plane, that is one example of a planar motion. And as we had seen, that a general motion need not be a pure translation or pure rotation, it will be a compression, it will be a combination of translation about one point or one axis and rotation, like we did in the ladder case. Okay, now let us define this a very important concept, which is the absolute and relative velocity in planar motion. Now, what we do is this, that in a rigid body, what we had seen earlier, that only when a rigid body undergoes pure translation, then the velocity of each and every point on that rigid body is the same. But as we just saw, okay, that any general planar motion can be a combination of a rotation and a translation. And because of that, what happens? Because of that, any point A and B, even though the motion will have a course in such a way that in the course of its motion, the distance AB will not change. Why? Because this is a rigid body and by definition, this distance cannot change. But point A and B can keep having different velocities which have different magnitudes and different direction. Now, there is a relation between them, okay, but they need not be the same. Now, how do we relate? Take two generic point A and B, and how do we take the relation between what is the velocity at point A and what is the velocity at point B? Now, let us see what do we do is that this motion, we break it into two parts. We had seen that any planar motion can be broken into rotation about a point plus a translation. Now, how do we break it? We break it into two parts. One is a complete translation, okay, a complete translation with A, okay, that this entire rigid body is translated, plus a rotation about A. What is this rotation? This is the rotation. Now, what is happening here? That in this particular thing, the overall velocity of point B will be nothing, but look at this component. This component, velocity of point B is what? Is the translation, okay, or the translational velocity that we have undergone here, which is nothing but the velocity of A. So, it is VA plus V of B with respect to A. So, this is a standard statement that velocity of B is nothing but velocity of A plus velocity of B with respect to A. Now, what do we do? Okay. So, here what we have done is that we have taken this entire object and given it a translation, okay, or given it a velocity in the direction of A, okay, and plus rotation about A. Now, how do we replace that? Now, the velocity of B with respect to A will be what? That what is the velocity that point B C when with respect to A? But we just saw, okay, that one component is this total V A. So, this part, okay, so velocity of B has two parts. One is this component plus the second component that comes because of the rotation of this rigid body about point A, okay. So, first part is that we have broken down this motion into two parts. One is this translation with respect to A, VA, VA. And so, what is the total velocity of A is just VA plus, because in the second case, we are doing pure rotation about A, this point, okay, okay, has no velocity, no acceleration, nothing. So, the total velocity of point A is equal to VA plus this, but the total velocity of point B, okay, VB will be what? This VA, which is broken into one part VA, plus the velocity component that comes because of pure rotation about A. So, we can say that my total velocity is nothing but this VA plus what is this? That with respect to point A, what is the velocity with respect to point A, which is nothing but this component. Now, what is this component? These components come purely from rotation about point A, and that can be written as omega k cross this relative position of B with respect to A. And this can be written as r omega. The magnitude is clearly this is the r. Omega is the angular velocity about this point A. And so, we can write down that the overall velocity of point B is nothing but VA, okay, which is given to us, plus omega k bar cross, what is k bar? K bar is the unit vector along the z direction, r of B with respect to A, or the position vector of B with respect to A. Now, if you recall, okay, if you recall what, if we just discuss this with the help of a simple example, the point will become very clear. And this is precisely the point that we had discussed when we used the principle of virtual work, where we had provided a combination of infinitesimal translation and rotation, okay, to rigid bodies. Now, let us take our favorite example, okay, which is equivalent to a ladder, that this object, okay, AB, can have velocity at point A in this direction, VA, can have velocity of point B in the downward direction. Now, what we can do? We can say that the overall motion that this object can undergo, it cannot undergo, it is a 1 degree of freedom object. Why? Because this VA and VB cannot be unconnected, because if VA and VB are unconnected, what will that mean? That means that point A and B, the distance between them will either try to decrease or try to increase, which is not allowed for a rigid body. So, we break this motion into two parts. What are the two parts? One is pure translation, okay. What is that translation? We give it the same translation as A, same velocity as A. But in addition, what we say now, that the overall motion of this object is a combination of this pure translation plus rotation about point A. Now, what is that rotation about point A? When we are doing this motion, A is fixed. So, there is no velocity for point A. But what is the velocity for point B? Velocity for point B, even our simple geometric intuition will tell us that we want to rotate in this direction, okay. If this is the direction of rotation, then what will happen is that the velocity will be perpendicular to this rod, which is velocity of B with respect to A. Now, what do? We form this triangle, that this is VA, this is VB. And what do we know? That VA plus velocity of B with respect to A will be equal to VB. Now, this is little bit complicated, okay, we are doing vector algebra. In the next, okay, in the next few moments, I will also briefly discuss how can we easily do this without resorting to any vector notation. Okay, but just bear with me here. Why? Because this is a systematic way of doing these problems. So, this is VA, this is VB with respect to A. Now, how does our geometry play a role? What we clearly know is that this relative velocity should be perpendicular to the position vector of B with respect to A. Since we know this angle, we immediately know that this is theta, this is 90 minus theta. So, this angle also has to be theta. So, we know what is this angle theta. If now we know what is VA, suppose VA is given to us, what we know? That VA divided by VB or VB divided by VA should be equal to tan theta. So, if we know what is VA, we immediately know that the relation between VA and VB is equal to tan theta. Now, doesn't this look familiar? If you recall when we did principle of virtual work, that for that ladder problem, we gave it a virtual displacement in the horizontal direction and vertical direction such that there is no loss of contact between A and B for that ladder. Also, there is no change in the length of ladder A and B, and what we had seen there? We had seen that delta x by delta y, okay, or delta y by delta x is equal to this tan theta. Similarly, that delta y is now replaced by VB. Why? Because delta y divided by delta t will be nothing but VB. Similarly, at this point, okay, what is VA? In that case, there was delta x and delta x divided by delta t. So, we divide and subtract, both the numerator and denominator in our virtual problem by delta t, and what will we get? That VB by VA will be equal to tan theta. So, we know from this vector algebra, we also, if you recall our virtual work discussions properly, we'll see that both of them are consistent with respect to each other. So, VB by VA is also equal to tan theta. But now note one thing, what else do we know? We also know, okay, from this expression that VA divided by V of B with respect to A, the magnitudes should be equal to cos theta. But what is the magnitude of this? The magnitude of this is nothing but the length times omega. And isn't it the same as saying that if we give this thing in our virtual work discussion, a small rotation of delta theta about point A, then the virtual displacement here will be how much? Will be equal to L times delta theta. Now, just divide that by delta t, what will we see? That this is nothing but L delta theta by delta t, which is omega. So, what we had discussed in principle of virtual work, that same kinematics we are also seeing here, okay, albeit we are seeing it from a more formal discussion, but what we see here is that VA divided by VB, B with respect to A is nothing but L omega, and this is equal to cos theta. Now, we are done. What is the omega, what is the acceleration, or what is the angular rotation of this? We immediately can find out and say that this will be equal to VA divided by L cos theta. And once we know VA, we also can find out what is VB. So, straightforward. So, the idea is that we just break our overall motion into a combination of two motion. One, a translation, and other rotation about point. Now, you may ask me that what point should I choose? Why should I choose point A? Why cannot choose point B? It completely depends on what you are comfortable with, and many a times it depends on the geometry of the problem. You can also repeat this entire problem by a translation about B, okay, translation in the vertical direction and a rotation about point B. And you will see that you will get exactly same answer by exactly similar consideration. Only difference is that in this case, V of A will be equal to V of B plus velocity of A with respect to B, and velocity of A with respect to B is nothing but minus of velocity of B with respect to A. That will be the only difference. Otherwise, you will see that this problem, okay, we can break down the overall motion. Why? Because there is a constraint that the length of AB cannot change. So, we break it down into two parts. One is pure translation and rotation about A, or we break it into a pure translation in the vertical direction, okay, following what is the velocity of B plus a rotation about point B. And both are equivalent as far as the overall kinematics of this rigid motion is concerned. Now, this is this famous piston problem which we had just done earlier. Okay, if you recall the problem we had done earlier, so what we will do is that this piston problem, okay, this is the crank, okay, a crank and a piston problem, that this is something which so this is an assembly. Okay, if you remember, even when we did principle of virtual work, we had a similar problem which we had solved. And now what we are asked to find out, okay, that this crank AB has a constant clockwise angular velocity of 200 rpm. Okay, so the angular velocity is clockwise in this direction. What is it? It is 2000 rotations per minute. And now what we are asked to find out, that for that angular speed, for find out that in this position, when all the dimensions and all the angles are given, the angular velocity of the connecting rod BD. Okay, so what will be the angular velocity of the rod BD and the velocity of piston P? That what is the velocity of this point D? Now we can do this problem in two ways. One is the formal way in which we had done the problem earlier, but before I do that, we had just done a few moments ago. Let me discuss this problem very easily using the virtual work kinematics that we had done previously. The problem which we had discussed previously, what we had is this. This is essentially our assembly A, B. Why I am using these various approaches is that what we are seeing is that, right, that we use vectorial approach, we use the approach which is more geometric, which we had done previously. Okay, whatever way you do, you get the same answer. And that is to emphasize that and also to relate that the whatever concepts we had learnt in virtual work, okay, they are not waste. Okay, that even if you don't use the principle of virtual work, those concepts will give us a very good understanding of kinematics. Okay, or at least how does the rotation of a rigid body happen when you have multiply connected rigid bodies. This is B and this is point C. What is this point C? This point C is free to slide. So, we replace that with a roller. This is length L1, this is length L2, this is theta 1, this is theta 2. Now, what we want to do is that if this assembly, okay, rotates in the clockwise direction by an angle delta theta 1, rod AB. What will happen? If I draw this rod AB separately, what do we get? This is the initial position of the rod. After rotation, you will see that this is how the rod position will move from B to B prime. Okay, this is A. What is this distance BB prime? This angle is delta theta 1. So, this distance BB prime is nothing but L times L1 times delta theta 1. How much is the vertical distance, okay, delta B in the downward direction? How much is that equal to? Okay, if you do the geometry, if you recall what we had done in principle of virtual work, this will be simply but L1 cos theta delta theta 1. How much will be delta B in the horizontal direction? Will be L sin theta delta theta 1. Now, let us say that I take this rod BC and I do not move this point C to begin with. Let us keep the point C here, but let us give it a rotation now in the anticlockwise direction about point C. Okay? This is the anticlockwise rotation. This is the original position of BC. So, this point B, okay, sorry, this is the original position of BC. We give it a rotation like this in the anticlockwise direction. So, what happens is that the split will happen like this, okay. This point will go inwards, okay. This point will also go in the inward direction. And so, finally, after giving these two rotations, what do we see? That this was the initial position A, B, C. After the rotation, what do we see? Like this and like this. We had seen earlier that delta B in the downward direction is equal to L 1 cos theta 1 delta theta 1, and delta B in the sideways direction is equal to L 1 sin theta 1 delta theta 1. Similarly, delta B coming from rod BC in the direct downward direction will be L 2 cos theta 2 delta theta 2, and delta B coming in the inward direction here from rod BC will be L 2 sin theta 2 delta theta 2. Now, what we want is that we don't want this gap or this split to happen, okay. This vertical and horizontal split, it cannot happen. So, first we do one simple thing. We make sure that the vertical displacements from both sides are the same. So, what do we get? L 1 cos theta 1 delta theta 1 is equal to L 2 cos theta 2 delta theta 2. So, what do we learn from this? We learn that L 1 by L 2 cos theta 1 by cos theta 2 into delta theta 1 is equal to delta theta 2. Now, this rotation was in the clockwise direction, okay, and this rotation is now in the anticlockwise direction. Now, if we just say that we divide it by delta t on both sides, then this is omega, and we immediately find that if this is omega, okay, if this is omega, the rod AB is rotating with a clockwise with an angular velocity omega, then correspondingly in a given configuration theta 1 and theta 2, we will see that the angular velocity of rod BC has to be equal to L 1 by L 2 cos theta 1 by cos theta 2 into omega. So, whatever kinematics we had discussed in the virtual work method, they again work. Now, the last question is that we want to find out what is the overall displacement of this thing in the horizontal direction. Now, how we decide that? That there is a split now that has come in the horizontal direction. We want to clear that split. Now, how do we clear that split? We just realize is that to clear that split, this entire assembly has to be translated to the left by how much distance? By this delta B plus this delta B. And what is that equal to? That will be L 1 sin theta 1 delta theta 1 plus L 2 sin theta 2 delta theta 2. Now, what we know delta theta 2 in terms of delta theta 1. So, we just substitute that value here, okay. Let us bring this delta theta 1 outside. This goes here, this becomes delta theta 2 by delta theta 1. What is that ratio? That ratio comes from here, and divide everything by time t, we will see that this has to be the velocity of this point C in the horizontal direction. So, the ideas that we had used in the principle of virtual work, okay, you can use the same ideas here. Only thing you realize is that there we had discussed in terms of delta x, delta y, delta theta. Now, we have to just divide everything by delta t, and delta theta will be replaced by omega, delta x will be replaced by v, delta y will be replaced by v in the vertical direction. Okay? So, this I realize is a tangent, but why I really wanted to bring it up is to make connection that whatever we have learnt in the principle of virtual work, that same kinematics is actually applicable here also. Now, we can take a more formal approach. We can say that the velocity, okay, at point D, okay, will be nothing but velocity of point B plus velocity of D with respect to B. What is omega? Omega is given to us. So, what is this velocity? This velocity of B will be perpendicular to the rod, and the magnitude will be nothing but AB into omega. So, straight away we know what is the magnitude of this velocity, which is nothing but R into omega or 75 into omega. Now, what do we learn from this? What we learn is that for this motion, okay, for the direction of the absolute velocity Vd is horizontal and the direction of relative velocity of Vdb is perpendicular to dB. Okay? So, we compute the angle between the horizontal and the connecting rod from the law of sines. So, what we see is that, so the way I write is that this is V of D, this is V of B, okay? And this has to be velocity of D with respect to B. And now, what do we know from here straight away is this angle is given to us. This angle comes from here. How much is that? This angle is 40 degrees. Okay. So, what do we use? We use rule of sines here and we say that sine 40, okay, by 200. Why do we say 200 here? Because so this was rod BD. The overall motion was taken to be the translation, okay, in the direction like this, okay, which is BD plus rotation with respect to this. What is this distance? This is 200, okay, and as a result this relative velocity V of D comma B is nothing but this 200 into omega for rod BD. Okay? So, we then use this rule of sine here because the omega will get cancelled out. Okay? So, sine 40 by sine beta, okay, what is the, so this is just to find out what is the vertical, what is the sine beta here. We are finding out that the vertical distance from here to here is the same as this. So, AB sine 40 is the same as 75 sine 40. But now to find out overall, okay, what we have done that the planar motion can be broken into two parts, translation along this direction VB plus rotation about point B, okay, and what is the direction of VDB is what we had discussed here. So, VDB magnitude is nothing but omega BD into L and this magnitude here for VB is already given to us, which was, okay, from this previous slide given as omega into AB. So, we form this triangle here, this is known to us, this VD has only to be horizontal. So, this angle is also known to us, this is known, this angle is also known to us. On top of that, what we also know that what is the angle of this relative velocity with respect to D. Why? Because this has to be perpendicular to this. So, by using simple geometry, what we will realize is that the angle of relative velocity of point D with respect to B is also known to us. So, then we can use rule of sines that Vd divided by sine 53.95, which is this angle, is equal to relative velocity of D with respect to B, okay, this divided by sine 50. But what is relative velocity of D with respect to B is nothing but this length into omega Bd, and from that we can immediately find out what is this, Vdb is this, and Vdb is nothing but omega Bd times L. And from this expression, we divide Vdb divided by L and find out what is the rotation of this entire rod. Okay? So, that is the final rotation that we will get. And I urge you to solve this problem both using vectorial notation and the virtual work notation that we had done before. I realized that the explanation I gave was a bit choppy. Okay? So, if you have doubts, okay, I will be glad to entertain them. Okay. The one question is asked by center 123A, how to choose the fixed point? Okay, choosing the fixed point is completely up to you, but in this case, okay, especially in this problem, why is what a good idea to choose B as the fixed point? As far as the rod BD is concerned, it was a good idea to choose B as the fixed point. Why? Because we immediately know that this AB, okay, and BD have a common point B, and because this rod is rotating, this crank is rotating about point A, we realize, we immediately know that the velocity at this point B, okay, the absolute velocity of this point B is nothing but omega times this length. Okay? So, this velocity is known to us, and since this velocity is known to us, we try to take the second motion in such a way, we say that it is a translation in this direction for B plus rotation about point B. Okay, so that is why we split it into two parts. We took B. We took this point B as our anchor. But we can as well do this problem by saying that the total, how does the total motion happen? That it is translation with respect to velocity of A and rotation about point A. But because we do not know rotation velocity of A to begin with, in this case it becomes very nice if you look at this point B and refer everything, okay, with respect to this point B. That velocity of point D is referred in terms of B as opposed to D, B referred in terms of point D. Okay, so that is a simple logic here because we know what is the velocity here. Second question is by center again 1, 2, 3, 8. They have said please explain how omega cross r is equal to minus omega square r is valid. Okay, let us explain this. In planar motion, this is r bar, okay, omega bar, let us say this is x, this is y, this is theta, and omega is nothing but the magnitude omega k hat. What is k hat? Is a unit vector in the z direction. Now, what is the velocity? Okay, v bar is equal to omega is equal to r cross omega. Now, what is r cross omega? If you think about it, what is r cross omega? What will be the direction? The direction of this will be perpendicular to this. What will be the magnitude? R and omega are both perpendicular to each other. Why? Because omega has a component only in the k direction, whereas r has a component only in the plane, omega has a component only out of plane. So, this can as well be written as E tangent, okay, into r omega, that is equal to v bar, where this is unit vector in the tangential direction. Now, if we do omega cross r cross omega, then what do we get? We get omega into k cross r into omega e t. So, this can be written as omega square r k bar cross e t, and if you do k bar cross e t, this is e t, okay, k bar is out of the plane, you will realize that this will be nothing but equal to minus omega square r, and the resultant direction will be perpendicular both to e t and as well to the unit vector in the k direction, and this will be nothing but E n, or the velocity or the unit vector in the normal direction. So, that is why we say that omega cross r bar cross omega can be written as minus omega square r E n, or its magnitude is minus omega square r and it acting inwards. Okay, it is very similar to our motion in the curvilinear direction, but now what do we have is that there is a relation between the tangential direction, okay, and the normal direction, and everything can be linked together with this quantity omega and alpha. So, that is why you get this quantity minus omega square cross E n. Okay, just do the geometry, this will become even more clear. There is a question by 1314 saying, sir, shall we consider jerk and impact are same? Not necessarily, okay, because jerk is rate of change of acceleration. So, clearly jerk is rate of change of acceleration, whereas impact, what is changing? It is changing the momentum. Okay, so jerk and acceleration need not always be equated. This is a question by 1305. How does reverse swing take place while bowling in cricket? Okay, so please look up. Okay, so there is something which is called as a Magnus effect, which happens because of the fluid drag acting on the ball. The ball has two roughs, one surface which is rough, one surface which is smooth. So the velocity of the air is different on two, and so that's why there is a differential drag and it moves the ball. Okay, for details, look up on various articles that will be available online. Last question, why does a top spin about a vertical axis? What is the mechanics behind this motion? So, top motion is a motion which is extremely complicated. Top does not spin just in a vertical way. If you realize that only when the speed of the top is very large, it just spins like this about a vertical axis. But you realize that sometimes, okay, if you do not spin the top in the appropriate way, the top gets inclined. And when it gets inclined, you will see, or even if the speed is low, the top gets inclined like this, and while spinning about its axis, it can also tend to rotate like this. So, that motion is called as precessive motion of the top, whereas now you also realize when the top starts slowing down, it does this motion, okay, it starts to wobble, and that wobbling motion is called as nutation. So, there are three motions for the top: one is spin, one is this rotary motion, rotational motion, which is called as precession, and other motion is a motion about the axis, which is called as the spin. okay, and all these three motions happen in a top, okay, or it can happen in a top depend on the angular speed of the top, depending on how is the initial inclination of the top, okay. This is way beyond what we are going to do in this course, okay. If you are interested in looking into that, look at any standard textbook in dynamics, and these problems for people who are more mathematically inclined, these are topics under analytical dynamics. So look up, for example, the standard books in physics like Goldstein, okay, where these problems are discussed in great details using what are called as Euler angles. Okay. So this is way beyond the topic of this course. Okay. But if you are interested, you can look in standard text. Last question, okay, before the lunch is by Center 1283. Right side ruler support, can the right beam, okay, move leftward? Okay. So let me come back to this problem again. Can this move leftward? Okay, it can also move leftward, but just think about it. If this moves leftward, then what happens? Then to accommodate this B, this rod has to move, okay, in the anticlockwise direction. Okay, but because we are given that the driving rod is going in the clockwise direction, okay, the overall geometry that we had discussed will mandate that this D has to move horizontally only in the right direction. So think about the geometry. If you can think in terms of the vector notation, or you can think in terms of the virtual displacement that we had given or that we had discussed during the principle of virtual work, whatever way you think about it, because this is given that this is clockwise, this D has to move inwards in the right direction, and overall if this is clockwise, this will automatically come out to be anticlockwise. Okay? So we will finish this portion. Okay, if you have more question about the kinematics, okay, we can discuss that. We will reconvene at 2 o'clock.